runs America? I guess that's the $10,000 question, isn't it? Maybe it's the $10 billion question.
America and most countries of the world, really, are run by a very small percentage of the population.
Not even the President of the United States. It's the money men.
Government aren't always the ones getting rich, so then you have to ask who are the ones behind it that are really getting rich, that are enjoying the benefits of this ripoff.
Inside the system, you know how you approach the power of the United States of America, how you lobby for a bill, how anyone can become president, how anyone can appeal to the people and ask for them to be voted into office. What happens if you go behind the scenes and just open the panel door and see how the system of power is really wired?
The interests of the American public have no bearing in the direction of the country, in the policy decisions. It doesn't matter which party we're talking about either. Republicans, Democrats, it's all the same thing. There is no voice for the people.
I think we're being controlled by a relatively small group of extremely powerful individuals that are pretty much pulling the strings behind both major parties, as well as the economic and financial institutions.
We're supposed to have the people being represented by the Congress, and this is a check and balance system. But instead, you have all branches of government owned by major corporations.
The folks who run America are the people who operate behind the scenes to make sure that the person who is in the seat of president and Congress and the people who we elect are the people that will do their bidding.
I think what you see is what it is, and who runs America are the banks and the multinationals. It's as simple as that, as I see it. They're the ones that have made all the decisions that have put us in the place that we're in now.
In 1937, Ferdinand Lundberg, who'd been a writer with the Wall Street Journal and other financial publications, wrote a book called America 60 Families. And in that book, he documented that the country was being run by an oligarchy of the wealthiest families, including the Mellons and the DuPonts and the Morgans and the Rockefellers and the Warburgs. And he showed that they were running the country as an invisible government behind the democracy that we see upon the surface.
In fact, a study by Princeton University has come out saying that the United States is more of an oligarchy than it is a republic or democracy. Why? Because the public has no say in the policies and in the system that's been set up by politicians.
Go back to 2008. Financial crisis is going on. Henry Paulson, U.S. Treasury Secretary. Where did he come from? Goldman Sachs, right, CEO. Gets in front of the American people and tells us that he's going to save us little people from the problems we have in the real estate market. But in order to do that, we have to bail out the too big to fails. Too big to fail. Four words shows you who's running the country. Capitalism is no such thing as too big to fail. It's fascism. It's a multinational takeover. We bailed out the banks.
It's the unseen people that I'm more concerned about, really, because there's got to be someone, somewhere, that creates the agenda that all these people must follow.
In the late 19th century, wealthy monopolists, most prominently John D. Rockefeller and J.P. Morgan, were growing in economic and political power. Americans were increasingly alarmed at Wall Street's domination of both the Democrat and Republican parties. This led, in the 1890s, to the formation of the grassroots Populist Party. The Rockefeller-Morgan axis decided to distract Americans with a new enemy, Spain. The choice was not coincidental. Spain ruled Cuba, which by the 19th century had become the world's richest colony and largest sugar producer. National City Bank coveted Cuba's white gold as a complement to Standard Oil's black gold. The Yellow Press, led by William Randolph Hearst, New York Journal, began inundating Americans with fabricated tales of Spanish oppression. Spaniards feeding Cubans to sharks, roasting Cuban priests, slaughtering hospital patients where no hospital even existed. The decision to send the Maine to Havana was made at a secret White House meeting of which no minutes were kept. The Spanish government was not expecting the Maine when it sailed into Havana Harbor. Captain Charles Sigsbee, captain of the Maine, said,
"It became known to me afterward that the Maine had not been expected, even by the United States Consul General."
By what oversight was no one in Havana notified of the battleship's arrival? However, no shooting erupted. The Spanish permitted the Maine to dock. For 3 weeks, the Maine sat in Havana Harbor. In the meantime, the Yellow Press drove anti-Spanish feelings to fever pitch. William Randolph Hearst paid bribes to have the correspondence of the Spanish ambassador spied upon. One letter, critical of McKinley, was stolen and reprinted in Hearst's journal under the headline, "The Worst Insult to the United States in Its History." 2 days later, a horrific explosion tore apart the Maine. 266 men were killed. A U.S. Naval Court of Inquiry attributed the explosion to an external device, but was unable to assign any blame. The Yellow Press had no reservations. The bombing, they claimed, was the work of the Spanish government. Americans were goaded into war with the battle cry, "Remember the Maine." Here, Spain is depicted as a semi-human brute, its bloodied hand on the grave of the Maine and its foot trampling an American flag. The war was immortalized in American public memory by one-sided naval victories. Teddy Roosevelt and his Rough Riders. And the charge up San Juan Hill. But did Spain really sink the Maine? All Spanish documents reveal that Spain wished to avoid war with America at all costs. Her mostly wooden navy could not hope to compete with the modern U.S. Navy, which consisted increasingly of steel ships. Admiral Cervera, who commanded Spain's Atlantic Squadron, warned his government of
"our lack of everything that is necessary for a naval war, such as supplies, ammunition, coal, provisions, etc. We have nothing at all."
A provocative act against America, such as sinking the Maine, was clearly the last thing desired by the Spanish. But who did want to sink the Maine? Detectives often solve crimes by examining who profited from them. To help finance the war, the Rockefellers National City Bank loaned the U.S. government $200 million. No income tax then existed. To help repay the loan, a telephone use tax was levied on the American people. It remained in effect for over a century. The loan was negotiated by Assistant Treasury Secretary Frank Vanderlip. After the war, National City Bank made Vanderlip its president. In that capacity, as we will see, he participated in the infamous Jekyll Island meeting, where the Federal Reserve Bank was secretly created. Mark Twain wrote,
"When the smoke was over, the dead buried, and the cost of the war came back to the people, it suddenly dawned on us that the cause of the Spanish-American War was the price of sugar."
The Rockefeller-Stillman National City Bank benefited most directly from it. for Cuba, soon afterward, became dotted with National City branches, and the Cuban sugar industry gravitated into National City's hands.
The Spanish-American War was the first war that persuaded Americans that the purpose of our military was not just self-defense, that we had to go overseas and fight wars on other people's behalf, and that became a pattern that continued ever since.
So without William Randolph Hearst, who championed this and who maybe was one of the people that stood to gain from the new possession gained from the Spanish-American War, without him and without Hearst's newspapers, there would have been no problem with the Maine.
The phrase false flag, I think, is becoming more and more familiar to more Americans than it used to be. First time I ever heard that phrase, probably about 20 years ago, and I thought, what does this mean? I think many Americans are still in that category. What does that mean?
Well, first off, so people understand what we're talking about with false flags, that goes back to the days of the old sailing ships, and everybody had their country's flag, and the idea was, it took a long time for two sailing ships to approach each other, and so they wanted to get up close so they could attack, and so they would put another country's flag up. You know, say they were pirates, they'd put a British flag up and then get right next to you. Then they'd run up the pirate flag and board your ship. So that's where it became known as a false flag. The event seems to be something other than what it truly is.
False flags, when you cover them, first of all, it's a tough term to even use, right? Because as soon as you say false flag, we've started conditioning people to see that as conspiratorial. And when anything's conspiratorial, that means it's not true, right? Because if you listen to most media, a conspiracy theorist or conspiracies are all urban legends, right? They're all myths. When in fact, there are many, many conspiracies all throughout American history and world history.
It's not even controversial to say that the United States has used false flag because it's now documented. It's a part of history.
General Smedley Butler wrote a book after World War I that I've read, and I know many of your viewers have as well, War is a Racket. And indeed, in many ways it is. And I think that we have noticed over the years that some of the events that led up to war were not accidental.
I found myself going back and looking at World War I, World War II, the Vietnam War, everything. Could we have been lied to about everything? And that was my fearful kind of approach to this is that even possible?
I would say they always follow a specific formula of create as much fear and trauma as possible. And then in that traumatization of the public, they're eliciting a specific psychological response. And that response is a cry for protection.
False flags have always been necessary to generate the kind of fear of outsiders or the imagined enemy that governments need in order to support the ridiculous policy of war in the first place.
Stage one is brute force. Stage two is staging something or creating an external enemy so that you then become the rescuer and people do what you say out of sheer fear. And then stage three is really getting to the point where you don't even require enemies any longer, where you can simply convince people through psychological manipulation to do the thing that you want them to do.
World War I is underway. Britain is at war with Germany. America has not yet joined the conflict. May 7th, a British ocean liner, RMS Lusitania, is on her way from New York to England. Nearly 200 Americans are among the passengers. 2:10 p.m., off Ireland's southern coast, a torpedo from a German U-boat strikes the Lusitania. More than 1,000 on board lose their lives. On both sides of the Atlantic, the public is told the Germans sank the Lusitania simply to kill women and children. The tragedy fans outrage and moves America closer to declaring war. In propaganda, Germany replaces Spain as the ape.
And because nearly every conflict
the U.S. has been involved in the 20th century has been based on a false flag pretext event, and the Lusitania is no different. That's how they got us into World War I. At the time, statesmen, senators, the American people in general wanted to mind their own business. They had a great industrial engine inside the United States. They were able to freely trade throughout the world and had no reason to engage in World War I. It wasn't their business. But unfortunately, the moneyed powers had other interests at hand.
At that point in the war, passenger ships and merchantmen were being armed. They'd been given orders to ram submarines. The submarines had no choice but to fire without warning.
Why did the Germans really sink the Lusitania? Because her hull was loaded with munitions. 6 million rounds of rifle ammunition, over 50 tons of shrapnel shells, and more than 60 tons of military explosives, including aluminum powder and gun cotton. The Lusitania was struck by a single torpedo, followed moments later by a massive explosion. The mighty ship disappeared beneath the waves in just 18 minutes. At the U.S. hearing investigating the incident, a critical piece of evidence went missing. President Woodrow Wilson ordered that the Lusitania's original manifest listing her munitions be hidden in the archives of the U.S. Treasury. Even more significant, evidence the Lusitania was deliberately sent to her doom.
The Lusitania was hauling munitions to the British that were going to be used against Germany in the war. And so the Germans took it out of the game.
Prior to the incident, Winston Churchill, then head of the British Admiralty, had ordered a study done to determine the political impact if the Germans sank a British passenger ship with Americans on board. President Woodrow Wilson's top advisor, Edward Mandell House, was in England at the time as Wilson's emissary. In the morning, on the day the Lusitania sank, House met with Edward Grey, Britain's foreign minister. House recorded,
"We spoke of the probability of an ocean liner being sunk, and I told him if this were done, a flame of indignation would sweep across America, which would in itself probably carry us into the war."
House and Grey then met with King George V at Buckingham Palace. House wrote,
"We fell to talking, strangely enough, of the probability of Germany sinking a transatlantic liner. The king said,
suppose they should sink the Lusitania, with American passengers on board."
That afternoon, the Lusitania was torpedoed. The British Admiralty had been well aware of a U-boat's presence in the South Irish Sea, from decoded intercepts of German naval communications and reports of the sub's activity in that region. Contrary to protocol, no warships were sent to escort the Lusitania, even though four destroyers were lying idle in the nearby port of Milford Haven. Commander Joseph Kenworthy, then in British Naval Intelligence, wrote,
"The Lusitania was sent at considerably reduced speed into an area where a U-boat was known to be waiting and with her escorts withdrawn."
Two leading books in this affair are The Lusitania by British historian Colin Simpson and Room 40 by Patrick Beasley. Beasley, considered the leading authority on the history of British naval intelligence, wrote,
"I am reluctantly driven to the conclusion that there was a conspiracy deliberately to put the Lusitania at risk in the hopes that even an abortive attack on her would bring the United States into the war."
When the ship was blown up containing American passengers, it became the raison d'etre into World War I. It was an outrageous and insidious enough event that Americans were reluctantly able to muster themselves and enter the war.
I think the most stunning example where there is so much historical evidence that no one even challenges anymore is the attack on Pearl Harbor.
Every time that anniversary comes around, we focus on Pearl Harbor Day because we want people to know the truth and want them to stop buying into the lies.
December 7th, 1941, the Japanese Navy attacks the United States fleet at Pearl Harbor in Hawaii, sinking or heavily damaging 18 naval vessels and leaving over 2,000 Americans dead. This is the event that propels America into World War II.
I had pretty much the same view that most Americans have, and that it was a dastardly attack. As President Roosevelt said, it was a day of infamy, you know.
It goes down in history now for having been such a sad, sad time.
December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy. The United States of America was suddenly and deliberately attacked by naval and air forces of the Empire of Japan.
Congress declares war, but the public wants to know why America was caught off guard. President Roosevelt appoints a commission to answer this question. The Roberts Commission was headed by Owen Roberts, a Supreme Court justice friendly with Roosevelt. The Roberts Commission declared that Washington officials had discharged their duties in an exemplary fashion. The fault for Pearl Harbor, it concluded, lay with their commanders in Hawaii, Pacific Fleet Commander Admiral Husband Kimmel and General Walter C. Short, the Army commanders in Hawaii. It's alleged these men failed to take adequate defensive and surveillance measures. The words dereliction of duty blazed on headlines across the country. Kimmel and Short were flooded with hate mail and received multiple death threats. It was claimed their negligence caused the deaths of thousands of Americans. Some members of Congress said the pair should be shot. Kimmel and Short, however, protested the Roberts Commission findings. Roberts had run an unusual hearing. Initially, evidence was heard without being recorded. Statements not made under oath. Kimmel and Short were denied the right to question witnesses or have fellow officers serve as legal counsel. The commission's report omitted significant testimony.
But we know behind the scenes that FDR knew quite a bit more. He was warned. And even behind that, FDR's shadow cabinet of advisors in the Council on Foreign Relations were provocating things behind the scenes. The American people were never meant to know the truth.
In 1944, a congressional resolution mandated the trials. That August, the Navy Court of Inquiry and the Army Pearl Harbor Board convened. At these proceedings, the attorneys for Kimmel and Short presented proof that Washington had complete foreknowledge of the Pearl Harbor attack, but had withheld this information from the commanders in Hawaii.
We needed one thing, which our own resources could not make available to us. That night vital need was the information available in Washington from the intercepted dispatches, which told when and where Japan was about to strike. It is my conviction that action by the Navy Department at any one of these significant dates in furnishing me the information from the intercepted messages would have altered the events of December 7, 1941.
Outraged, the Navy Court exonerated Admiral Kimmel and laid the blame squarely on Washington, D.C. The Army Pearl Harbor Board concluded Washington had full foreknowledge of the attack. Its report closed with these words.
Up to the morning of December 7, 1941, everything that the Japanese were planning to do was known to the United States.
But the American people did not learn the results. The Roosevelt administration ordered the trial verdicts to be made confidential.
He discovered later that his own superiors had gone to great lengths to make sure that he, Admiral Kimmel, did not have the information that was available in Washington.
Why was the fleet in Pearl Harbor when Franklin D. Roosevelt ordered the U.S. Pacific Fleet to move from the west coast to Pearl Harbor? The fleet commander, J.O. Richardson, went to Washington and he protested this decision. He said, Mr. President, our ships will be boxed in like sardines in Pearl Harbor. Hawaii is approachable from 360 degrees by potential attackers. We'll have to resupply across 2,000 miles of the Pacific. The only reason President Roosevelt could give Richardson for putting the fleet in Pearl Harbor was he said it would deter Japanese aggression. Well, as of December the 7th, 1941, everyone knew that putting the fleet in Pearl Harbor did not deter Japanese aggression.
A breakthrough came in 1982 with the publication of Infamy by John Toland, the Pulitzer Prize winner known as the Dean of World War II historians. By the time of Tolan's book, witnesses and information had emerged that had been previously unavailable. How did Washington know Pearl Harbor was coming? First, through decoded diplomatic messages. The Japanese used a code called PURPLE to communicate with their embassies and major consulates. Its complexity required enciphering and deciphering by machine. The Japanese considered the code unbreakable. But in 1940, U.S. Army cryptanalysts cracked it and devised a facsimile of the Japanese machine. As a result, U.S. intelligence was reading Japanese diplomatic messages, often on a same-day basis. Copies of the deciphered text were promptly delivered to President Roosevelt, as well as Army Chief of Staff General George Marshall and Secretary of State Cordell Hull. These messages revealed that the Japanese planned to rupture relations with America and had ordered their Berlin embassy to inform the Germans, their allies, that
the breaking out of war may come quicker than anyone dreams.
We were not going to go back into Europe because it had cost so many American lives in World War I, which was already dubbed the war to end all wars. Why would we possibly go back again when the American people knew full well it wasn't in their interest?
Pearl Harbor was absolutely necessary because, like all Democrats, FDR ran on a non-intervention and no-war platform. There's absolutely no way that the people would have again been sucked into this meat grinder.
So although that is not classically a false flag because the Japanese actually did the attack, it fits under that umbrella because we find out that the U.S. government wanted the Japanese to attack.
They left certain ships all next to each other so they could be more easily hit and got the more expensive and newer and more capable ships out of there so that they would not become collateral damage.
Brigadier General Elliot Thorpe was the U.S. military observer in Java, then under Dutch control. In early December 1941, the Dutch Army decoded a Japanese dispatch forecasting an attack on Hawaii. They passed the information to Thorpe, who was so alarmed he sent Washington a total of 4 warnings. Finally, the War Department ordered him to send no further warnings regarding Pearl Harbor. Dusko Popov was a Yugoslavian double agent whose true allegiance was to the Allies. Through contact with the Germans, Popov realized the Japanese were planning to bomb Pearl Harbor. He notified the FBI. Subsequently, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover stated that he had passed this information on to Roosevelt. Iowa Senator Guy Gillette and Texas Congressman Martin Dies also later stated they had received advance information concerning the attack, which they shared with the president. Roosevelt told them to leave it in his hands. In Day of Deceit, The Truth About FDR and Pearl Harbor, Robert Stennett proved from documents obtained through the Freedom of Information Act that Washington was not only deciphering Japanese diplomatic messages, but naval dispatches also. The most significant was sent by Admiral Yamamoto to the Japanese First Air Fleet on November 26, 1941.
The task force, keeping its movement strictly secret and maintaining close guard against submarines and aircraft, shall advance into Hawaiian waters, and upon the very opening of hostilities, shall attack the main force of the United States fleet and deal it a mortal blow. The first air raid is planned for the dawn of X day. Exact date to be given by later order.
Whether we're looking at something like Pearl Harbor, which is now an admitted false flag event, or it's an event that was clearly allowed to occur, it was known about and no action was taken to prevent it or stop it. So that could qualify as a false flag event. Whether you're looking at an event that, like the Gulf of Tonkin, which was a fake false flag event. It was something that we were told occurred and actually didn't even occur. This has been called by some researchers, like David Icke, for example, as no problem reaction solution. You don't even have to have the actual physical event take place. You only need the perception of it to take place.
In retaliation for this unprovoked attack on the high seas, our forces have struck the bases used by the North Vietnamese patrol craft.
In many cases, these individuals who plan these events, they're playing chess while we're not even playing checkers yet. You know, we have to understand what they're doing. The event isn't as important as the underlying psychology that the event is done to elicit. And until we understand that pattern, we're not going to be streetwise to the technique.
In the event of a further attack upon our vessels in international waters, we are to respond with the objective of destroying the attackers.
Look at those Vietnamese, man, up in north. We better stop them right away. If we don't stop those communist North Vietnamese, they're going to take over South Vietnam, then Thailand, then Laos, and then Cambodia. And before you know it, those dominoes will be falling until they hit the shores of California. Now, you could say I sound like a lunatic for saying something so stupid, but that's what was being said back then, and I know firsthand because I was prime draft age of that time.
These guys are professionals at it, and they know how to take advantage of it. And of course, one of the most horrible ones in our lifetime was in August of 64 when Lyndon Johnson faked the Gulf of Tonkin.
In 1964, Congress passed the Tonkin Gulf Resolution, authorizing President Lyndon Johnson to escalate the Vietnam War, to which he committed hundreds of thousands of troops. The justification given for the resolution was two alleged attacks on U.S. destroyers by Vietnamese torpedo boats in the Tonkin Gulf, August 2nd and August 4th, 1964. Johnson described the first attack as an unprovoked assault against a routine patrol. Actually, the destroyer was supporting a South Vietnamese military operation against the North. The second attack never occurred. Admiral James Stockdale, recipient of the Congressional Medal of Honor, was then a pilot stationed in the Tonkin Gulf. Later shot down, he spent 7 years in a POW camp. After returning home, he summarized his experiences in his book, In Love and War. Stockdale was called to the scene of the alleged August 4th attack, but saw no Vietnamese boats during 1.5 hours of overflight.
Well, I was over those destroyers as what I for over an hour and a half, below 1,000 feet, lights off, watching everything they did. I could hear them chatting on the radio, the Maddox and the Joy. They seemed to have some intermittent radar targets. I took it upon myself to get out there where they thought a boat was and try to kill it if they didn't. But it was fruitless. And I'd go down there and there was nothing.
I felt it was a bad portent that we seemed to be under the control of a mindless Washington bureaucracy, vain enough to pick their own legitimacies, regardless of the evidence.
Today, very few people dispute that the Tonkin Gulf incident didn't take place.
Later, it was revealed that the Tonkin Gulf Resolution was written before the alleged incident. The document was simply awaiting on an excuse to activate it.
The whole Gulf of Tonkin incident, a lie by slimy little people like Robert McNamara and LBJ. And every one of those people knew it was a lie, and they sacrificed the lives of 60,000 American boys, destroyed the lives, limbs, and minds of hundreds of thousands of others, killed over 3 million Vietnamese, napalmed it, Agent Orange it on lies.
They died in a just cause for defending freedom, and they will not have died in vain.
The main justification currently given for the Iraq War, bringing freedom and democracy to the Iraqi people, was not the original reason presented.
The next mushroom cloud you see, maybe one of Saddam Hussein's weapons. You remember that one?
Last November 8th, this council passed Resolution 1441 by unanimous vote. The purpose of that resolution was to disarm Iraq of its weapons of mass destruction.
It was claimed Saddam Hussein possessed weapons of mass destruction, or WMDs, threatening world security.
This council placed the burden on Iraq to comply and disarm, and not on the inspectors to find that which Iraq has gone out of its way to conceal for so long.
There is only one truth, and therefore
I tell you, as I have said on many occasions before, that Iraq has no weapons of mass destruction whatsoever.
After the invasion, Chief U.S. Weapons Inspector David Kaye acknowledged months of searching had turned up no weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. In his opinion, they hadn't existed there since the 1991 Gulf War.
Why aren't there any war crime tribunals for these people? Who knew what when?
Either you are with us, or you are with the terrorists.
An interview with Scott Ritter, who was the UN's chief weapons inspector in Iraq, who affirmed that there were no weapons of mass destruction in Iraq after the original Gulf War of 1991.
Weapons of mass destruction, I thought, you know, who could believe this? I mean, who's believing this yellow cake from Niger story and the whole thing?
And still no accountability for the fact that we went into another country looking for weapons that weren't there, and we killed 500,000 people. One thing that the Bush administration did a very good job of with the help of media was to shift the focus away from any reality of weapons, terrorism. So what they did was the administration immediately shifted to, we're bringing democracy.
Now look, part of the reason we went into Iraq was, the main reason we went into Iraq at the time was we thought he had weapons of mass destruction. It turns out he didn't, but he had the capacity to make weapons of mass destruction. But I also talked about the human suffering in Iraq. And I also talked the need to advance a freedom agenda.
And still to this day, there are people, especially neocons, who believe that argument. That all these wars that we've had in the Middle East, which have again turned the Middle East into chaos, that have handed it over to Al-Qaeda so that we can go back, I guess, and fight them again later there. It was done so that freedom could come to an oppressed people.
Colin Powell, who made such definite assertions before the UN, has admitted his claims were based on faulty intelligence.
The little lying Colin Powell, putting a phony information in front of the UN. These are Saddam Hussein's mobile weapons of mass destruction labs. It's one lie after another.
Looking at these wars, Spanish-American, World War II, Vietnam, and Iraq, one could soundly argue that in each war, American involvement was based on a deception, false pretext, or to put it charitably, mistaken pretext.
One lie after another, keep pouring them out. These are sick people and nobody wants to call a spade.
Could this really be one giant coincidence? Patterns of this scale generally do not happen by accident. To find the answer, deeper questions remain.
When our country was founded, it was founded by an elite group. The founding fathers were the educated ones, the ones who had land, the ones who'd studied in Europe, the ones who'd read history and philosophy. And thank God it was that way. It's still true in America today, but the elite has changed.
It's a great debate of whether or not we're founded on our lineage and our heritage of the Constitution and Bill of Rights or from hidden interests.
Who runs the country? Well, the political parties run the country, but we all know the political parties actually don't do anything on their own.
I think the reality is that we're probably ruled for the most part by an oligarchy.
The people still elect members of Congress. But beyond that, once someone is in Congress, the special interest groups take over, the lobbying firms take over, very wealthy families take over, and the people have absolutely no voice.
A super elite, very powerful, very wealthy individuals who have, I will use the word, conspired together to take advantage of the opportunities afforded them in their positions of power and influence, to pretty much determine the direction and the course of our country, irrespective of the wishes of the American people.
I think in any culture, in any country, you can look to who has the money. The people with the money typically tend to wield the power. And the best way to do that is to do it from behind the scenes, because then if people become angry with the way power is being wielded, they don't come after you, they come after the puppet standing in front of you.
We all know about a lot of wealthy people, Warren Buffett and Donald Trump, and you know, but these are the guys that you hear about. The people, they got lots of money, yeah, but the people with the real power, you don't even hear their names.
We start seeing all of these names of large corporations that come together over and over again, and then they get intertwined into events that take place, and then we start to see there's a pattern and there is a real agenda.
In America's 60 Families, Ferdinand Lundberg wrote,
"The United States is owned and dominated by a hierarchy of its 60 richest families, functioning discreetly in a de jure democratic form of government, behind which a de facto government, absolutist and plutocratic, has gradually taken form. This de facto government is actually the government of the United States, informal, invisible, shadowy."
Among the 60 families Lundberg named were the Rockefellers, Morgans, Mellons, Vanderbilts, DuPonts, Astors, and Warburgs. Through inherited fortunes, they remained entrenched in power from one generation to the next. These families frequently acted in concert to pre-select presidential candidates of both Republican and Democratic parties, and, as Lundberg documented, acquired sweeping ownership of America's major newspapers.
For the last several decades, let's admit, the powers that be have pretty much been the ones that have really made the decisions irrespective of the will of the American people.
This power structure has been called the establishment. Syndicated columnist Edith Kermit Roosevelt, granddaughter of President Theodore Roosevelt, described it.
Establishment is a general term for the power elite in international finance, business, and government, who wield most of the power regardless of who is in the White House. Most people are unaware of the existence of this legitimate mafia, yet the power of the establishment makes itself felt from the professor who seeks a foundation grant to the candidate for a cabinet post or State Department job. It affects the nation's policies in almost every area.
In America, in principle, power is supposed to belong to the people. Voting sustains the public perception that it retains power. However, the establishment has ways of getting around our electoral system. First, through their influence within the major parties as well as the media, they can usually predetermine the Democratic and Republican nominees for president.
For years, I would tell people, if you don't go vote, you haven't got any right to gripe about what goes on because you're just not even part of the process. But I've quit saying that because now, even if you do go vote, in many instances, it doesn't really matter.
Oh, and I love the baloney that they keep shoving out every election. You know, if you don't vote, then you get what you deserve. No, if you vote, you get what you deserve. A lesser of two evils? What sick person would vote for a lesser of two evils?
In 1976, Jimmy Carter was elected president. 7 months before the Democratic convention, the Gallup poll reported less than 4% of registered Democrats favored Carter for president. Outside Georgia, where he was governor, few people knew who he was. What happened?
There's a new mood in America. We've been shaken by a tragic war abroad, and by scandals and broken promises at home.
Carter received a media blitz, including adulatory pieces in the New York Times and a Wall Street Journal editorial declaring him the best Democratic candidate. The TV networks inundated the public with his image. Before the nominating convention, his picture appeared on Time's cover 3 times and Newsweek's cover 2x. Time's cover artists were instructed to make him look as much like John F. Kennedy as possible. How did Carter acquire this media following? It began with dinner at the Tarrytown, New York estate of David Rockefeller. Present was Zbigniew Brzezinski, who helped Rockefeller found the Internationalist Trilateral Commission, and whom Carter would later appoint National Security Advisor. Senator Barry Goldwater said of this meeting,
"David Rockefeller and Zbigniew Brzezinski found Jimmy Carter to be their ideal candidate. They helped him win the nomination and the presidency. To accomplish this purpose, they mobilized the money power of the Wall Street bankers and the media controllers."
Carter thus received the nomination. A similar process has anointed campaigns of other major party presidential nominees of the last few decades.
The people have no real say, including in who is elected to office. in this country. I mean, consider this. In the United States, about 50% of the population are no longer affiliated with Republicans and Democrats. So 50% of the population is not voting for Republicans or Democrats. Tell me which national election member of the House, member of the US Senate, a president has been elected in the last 100 years who was not a member of one of those parties. Now, how is it possible that half the country isn't voting for Republicans or Democrats because they're not affiliated with those parties, and yet those are the only two options that we still have? I mean, that I think that demonstrates to people how corrupt the system is, because you are literally kept from having any other option and any other choice.
Because of the manipulation of the mainstream media, public education, most of the entertainment world, as well as the political world, so many of the American people are sedated, and they do not engage in the areas in which they could make a difference.
The good news is, I think we're hitting a tipping point where the people, you're now hitting critical mass, obviously, when you have 50% of the country that's no longer a part of it, where, you know, it just takes a very small minority now to really push things in a different direction.
We had George Bush trying to get reelected, and John Kerry was his adversary, alleged. As it turned out, there was massive electronic vote fraud in one of the swing states, Ohio. It turned out that John Kerry actually won. It was given to Bush. A year or so later, there's a young law student down in the University of Florida, and John Kerry is speaking down there. And the law student had the cojones to go over and get in front of the microphone when they asked him, when they opened it to questions. And he asked John Kerry, how come he didn't make more of a squawk about this?
And he says you won the 2004 election. Right. Isn't that amazing? You won in 2004.
It was obviously he had won. It wouldn't mean the difference between not only him being president, but what the different party would be in. And it was a very powerful question. You know what the response was? John Kerry gave a little nod or something, because the next thing we know, there's a goon squad of about six that come and drag the young law student right out of the auditorium.
However, the establishment has an even more powerful means of influencing the will of the people. The most important is the Council on Foreign Relations, or CFR, headquartered in New York City. Though virtually unknown to the public, the council dominates cabinets of both Republican and Democratic presidents.
When you look at where the wires are connected to the centers of power, you will find again and again that places like the Council on Foreign Relations don't just float ideas, they provide solutions.
You often find members of the Council on Foreign Relations being appointed to various positions in government or industry, for that matter, and you see them in the revolving door going back and forth between business and regulatory agencies and stuff like that. The big question is, how substantive is the CFR on global affairs?
Since its founding in 1921, the CFR has produced 21 secretaries of war and defense, 19 treasury secretaries, 18 secretaries of state, and 16 CIA directors. And what is the council's goal?
The Council on Foreign Relations is a fairly interesting entity to me. And the reason for that is because they have so many members of the CFR who are in media.
I think the CFR exerts tremendous influence over our government, our media, and our centers of education, more so than most people would want to admit.
The Council on Foreign Relations is a very important nexus point, but it's just a vehicle for the larger aims of those who have an agenda. But it's an important vehicle. It's a ring of power that is an engine to encircle the whole world.
You know, once in a while, there'll be a spokesperson on the major media, and he'll be introduced as such and so, and they'll give credentials, and they'll mention a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. But that just, it sounds so innocuous, they just pass it, oh, it's some council that deals with foreign policy, so people don't remember that.
The number one thing people need to know is that when you have so many members of media who are a part of those organizations or that organization, you have lost the ability to have anyone criticizing globalist agenda or globalist viewpoints, because they are members of an organization that pronounces its view is to create, you know, globalism.
They have seized upon foreign policy, economics, and trade to get around the bounds of the Constitution and put their global system on top of America.
When I wrote The Shadows of Power, the main concern I had was that maybe I'd gone too far in attributing our foreign policy to this invisible government. Now it's 26 years later, we've had the arrival of the internet, I've had access to information I never had access to at the time I wrote that book. And my conclusion is that it's not that I went too far, but I didn't go far enough. When the Council on Foreign Relations was formed and the decision was made at a dinner at the Majestic Hotel in Paris in 1919, after the bankers got the word that the Senate had rejected the Versailles Treaty, so we weren't going to become embroiled in the League of Nations. So there was an organization created. It was in Britain, it was the Royal Institute of International Affairs. In America, it was the Council on Foreign Relations, like sister organizations.
These roundtable groups were put into formation to steer nations and steer their policies rather than control them overtly through direct leadership. They worked through secret maneuvers. The Cecil Rhodes Secret Foundation Trust had been involved not in nation building, but in nation manufacturing in the southern part of Africa. And now they wanted the entire world.
Now, how do they control American government policy? The number one way is by serving as a recruiting ground, the recruiting ground for cabinet-level positions. You've probably noticed that a lot of people in U.S. cabinets come from the big multinational corporations. How does that happen? Well, the Council on Foreign Relations will invite executives from Citibank or Exxon or Halliburton or Bechtel into the council. They'll attend maybe a study group, attend some dinners, hear some speeches by people like Henry Kissinger, Zbigniew Brzezinski. Now they become experts on policy, and now you see them showing up in the State Department or another major department. When you have one organization controlling the cabinet with a uniform viewpoint, whether the president is Republican or Democrat, naturally you're going to get uniform policies.
Here are some of the prominent members of the CFR, Council on Foreign Relations. George Herbert Walker Bush, Bill Clinton, Sandra Day O'Connor, Dick Cheney, Les Aspin, Colin Powell, Robert Gates, Brent Scowcroft, Jesse Jackson Sr., Mario Cuomo, Dan Rather, Tom Brokaw, David Brinkley, John Chancellor, Marvin Kalb, Diane Sawyer, Barbara Walters, Cyrus Vance, Paul Volcker, Henry Kissinger, George Shultz, Bruce Babbitt, Howard Baker, Samuel Berger, Elaine Chao, Dianne Feinstein, Ruth Bader Ginsburg, Chuck Hagel, Gary Hart, John McCain, George Mitchell, Bill Moyers, Jay Rockefeller, Donna Shalala, Strobe Talbot, Fred Thompson, Robert Zolick, Richard Nixon, Hubert Humphrey, George McGovern, Gerald Ford, Jimmy Carter, John Anderson, Walter Mondale, Michael Dukakis, Al Gore, John Kerry, on and on. I mean, you notice first of all that you're talking Republicans and Democrats, conservatives and liberals. You're talking people in every area of government and news media. You're talking education establishment. You're talking basically the key establishment institutions of the country are all infiltrated with Council on Foreign Relations members. Why is this institution so powerful that no matter whether it's a Republican or a Democrat in the White House, they are going to fill their administration with members of the CFR?
Admiral Chester Ward, former Judge Advocate General of the U.S. Navy, was a CFR member for 16 years. Before resigning in disgust, he stated the council's objective.
Submergence of U.S. sovereignty into an all-powerful one-world government. This lust to surrender the sovereignty and independence of the United States is pervasive throughout most of the membership.
This is a man who was also invited to become part of the CFR and was a member for a few years until he recognized what the CFR was all about. After finding that out, he withdrew his membership from the CFR, and then he did his best to inform the American people as to what the CFR was all about.
The Council's journal, Foreign Affairs, has pushed for world government for over 90 years. In its first year of publication, 1922, it declared, Obviously, there is going to be no peace or prosperity for mankind so long as it remains divided into 50 or 60 independent states. The real problem today is that of world government.
When you put all of that together, you recognize that the CFR, the Trilateral Commission, is nothing more but an elaborate attempt to, as they say themselves, make an end run around national sovereignty, diminish the independence and autonomy of the United States, and merge it into this global governing institution that they, of course, foresee themselves running.
My goodness, we're going toward everybody having a little bit and nobody having a whole lot, except for the elite. And we're going toward seeing all of our jobs taken away and put into another country. That's your world government for you. That's not benefiting the people in this country. So I absolutely, you know, I abhor the idea of world government. And I'm afraid that what we're going to see is the demise of many of our countries in the attempt to formulate this one big structure.
And it's obvious to see, okay, there are these very rich and powerful people meeting at, you know, under the guise of the CFR or the Bilderberg Group or a bunch of other things, but it really doesn't matter. The fact is the super class exists. That's the problem.
So whether it's a Brussels, whether it's a World Trade Organization, whatever it might be, it's still built on the premise of how do we steal the most amount of money that we can, put it in the hands of the fewest, and tell everybody else what to do.
It's not primarily driven by political ambition. It's driven by economic ambition. And just the fact that I mentioned that might change the flavor of the conversation, because talking about economics is a little bit different than just talking about politics. And one of the reasons, again, that the American experiment here is not working too well right now, as far as Congress is concerned, is because Congress is not an economic animal, it's a political animal.
What is world government? Simply stated, one regime ruling the planet.
I don't think anything's intrinsically wrong with the one world government. In fact, I think obviously we are just one humanity, and eventually we're going to get to that. You know, I can see perfectly well that there'll come a time when somebody's going to say, hey, where are you from? You're going to say, I'm from Earth. Okay? But the problem is, are we going to do this voluntarily? And are we all going to agree that we're going to have a world government and that we all have some sort of representation and the thing's done equitably and fairly, you know? Or are we going to have a handful of wealthy, egotistical, sometimes psychopathic people who want to control the world, who are going to foist it off on us? And unfortunately, this is what's happening right now.
I think what any subject of the New World Order would have to be concerned with is who basically is going to end up calling the shots.
Obviously, most people aren't thinking it all the way through. They have to realize that there's a difference between just saying we should have world government to put an end to war, and then asking the next question, but wait a minute, what kind of world government will this be? It might even be worse than war.
Countries act as a check and balance on each other. If one nation becomes despotic, another nation can rise up and stop it. If you had a one world government, it would set up the most unrestrained tyranny in history.
Already in the United States, with a population of over 300 million, you may be able to meet your representative, but your likelihood of knowing your representative as an average citizen is next to nothing. You may not even know who he or she is.
It only works in utopia. And so while this is something we might all strive for, without a massive shift in global consciousness, it's impossible.
Such a development is less remote than it may sound at first. It is being established progressively now. Modeled in Europe, where once mighty nations that oversaw empires such as Britain and Spain are becoming more like provinces of the European Union. Parliaments of EU countries grow increasingly subservient to the European Parliament. Laws are becoming more uniform throughout the Union. National currencies are consolidating into the Euro. The European Court of Justice can issue arrest warrants against citizens of member countries. Advocates of world government are planning a universal version of the EU model for the entire planet.
When you give up your identity as an individual nation, what you're essentially doing is giving up the identity of your people and the individuals within your society. Now they're just part of this kind of globalist worldview, and they don't have value anymore. So when we see what's happening in the Veneto region, when we see Scotland now saying that they are looking for independence, when we see Catalonia saying they want independence, if you believe in individual liberty, you should celebrate those movements. Because what those entities are essentially saying, as people, as individuals, we believe that we're more than just a member of your larger European Union, your larger global union. And instead, we want to be able to create goods and services, be paid for our labor, be paid for our work. And if we have to pay taxes, we should see a return on those taxes within our own communities. In a globalist world, you never see that return.
Globalists justify world government by promising peace and prosperity. Their traditional argument has been that nothing is worse than war. And wars occur because the world is divided into nations who keep fighting. They say if we replace nations with a world government, war would end. And mankind would live as one happy family in peace and prosperity. However, this pretext is flawed. Rudolf Rummel, Professor Emeritus of Political Science at the University of Hawaii, published a study demonstrating that in the 20th century, 6 times more people were killed by their own governments than by wars. In other words, wars are not the deadliest thing. Governments are.
What we know from the 20th century, that in nation after nation after nation, governments that became extraordinarily powerful had a very disconcerting tendency to kill their population. So you can look, for example, at the Soviet Union under Stalin, 60 million people killed. You can look at China under Mao Zedong, some estimates say well over 100 million people killed, some even say 200 million people killed. You can look at Nazi Germany as the example that probably most viewers are familiar with. Example after example, even ones that most people haven't even heard of.
The problem with world government is the same problem as with any government. Government is control by force. The more you concentrate that power, the worse it is. You could make the case that world government might be only as bad as local government, but obviously the bigger, the more concentrated that exploitation racket becomes, the greater chance there is for corruption.
All human authority is jurisdictional and limited. So whenever you violate that and you create a regional government and then a multi-regional government and then a global government, by very nature you have squelched and expunged the fundamental tenets and principles of liberty, natural rights, freedom, sovereignty under the states, individuals. It's all gone.
If we had a world government, who would run it? Globalists like to point out that international alliances have defeated dictators like Saddam Hussein. But what if a man like Hussein took over a world government? Today, if a tyrant enslaves a nation, its people may hopefully escape to another country. But if a dictator ruled a world government, where could anyone escape? America's founding fathers recognized the dangers of concentrating power. They therefore split government power into 3 branches. In the Founding Fathers' original vision, the power of the entire federal government would be held in check by the states. Decentralization of power has spared Americans the oppression of totalitarian dictatorships that other nations have known. James Madison, known as the father of the U.S. Constitution, said,
"The accumulation of all power, legislative, executive and judiciary, in the same hands may justly be pronounced the very definition of tyranny."
If we follow the money to see who is behind the Council on Foreign Relations, it becomes clear that the U.S. foreign policy establishment is intimately linked to Wall Street and the banking establishment. Americans know they have inflation. In 1962, a postage stamp cost 4 cents. Today, 49. A candy bar cost a nickel in 1962, now around a dollar. Since 1913, the dollar's purchasing power has declined over 95%. Inflation is not inevitable. This graph, depicts American price levels since 1665. There was no net inflation for the first 250 years. Inflationary blips occurred as during the American Revolution, War of 1812, and Civil War, when the United States printed large quantities of money to pay for those conflicts. Increasing the supply of money diminishes its value, making prices rise. But notice after the wars, money always returned to its normal value. A dollar was worth the same in 1900 as 1770. During World War I, our currency inflated, but instead of resuming to its normal value afterwards, American dollars, stable for 250 years, began rapidly and permanently losing value. This change came from one factor: creation of the Federal Reserve Bank in 1913.
The Federal Reserve is the most important part of the American government's racket of exploitation. And that's important to remember, that it's not about the wars. It's not about the police state. It's not about the business regulations. Those are all how. The why is power and money.
Time to pay attention, because the Federal Reserve has taken over the engine of the country and completely made it subservient to interest other than the actual country.
First off, it's not federal, and second off, it has no reserves. Okay, so the whole thing's a fraud to begin with.
The Constitution gives the Congress the power to coin money, but we've lost that by giving our power to a private corporation.
Janet Yellen is current chairman of the Federal Reserve Board. She was preceded by Ben Bernanke and Alan Greenspan. The Fed chairman has been called America's economic czar, largely because the chairman and board set U.S. interest rates, which impacts the stock market. If interest rates rise, CDs and other interest-bearing securities appear more profitable, causing money to flow away from the riskier stock market. However, when interest rates fall, investors tend to favor stocks.
Janet Yellen, the Fed chair, the new Fed chair, is going around saying that she will continue these policies of this quantitative easing, as it's called, which is essentially just the printing of money, and they're going to continue it until they can get the unemployment rates down. And she gives examples. She's talking like a president now, giving examples of the young woman that she's met in this community who struggles because she works multiple jobs. She's a single mom, and it's very difficult for her. Yeah, well, I'm sure it is difficult for her. But what no one ever tells you in media is that the reason that we have so many people struggling in this country is due in large part to the Federal Reserve Bank.
People who are closest to the money are the ones who get the greatest benefit. So whoever has had their hands on not just the Federal Reserve, but the whole infrastructure around it, the global banks that are peddling the Federal Reserve notes and the bonds and the treasury bills and so on, the Goldman Sachs of the world, the JP Morgans and so on, these companies and these individuals have consistently gotten rich beyond anybody's wildest imagination. The rest of us consistently have gotten poorer beyond our wildest imagination as well. So that the value of the dollar today is somewhere around 1.5% of what it was in 1913.
You know, the United States dollar, the Federal Reserve note dollar, has lost 98% of its value in the last 100 years. So if, number one, your first mandate is to protect the value of the currency, you failed. The second mandate on unemployment, as I mentioned, when the Fed chair is talking about this family that's in need and she wants to help them, how does the Federal Reserve help them? By holding interest rates low? That doesn't help families. That doesn't put food on my table. If anything, it makes it more difficult, because there are more people out there saying, well, then you should go get a loan right now. Borrow more money right now.
As has been stated in history, you know, whoever controls the money controls.
Again, it goes back to the money. It's not a world government. It's the bankers in charge. And again, the distribution of wealth right now in the United States, as everyone knows, is worse than it was at the Gilded Age over 100 years ago.
They are creating currency out of nothing with absolutely no value to it, promising us that, number one, this will lead to greater wealth across the nation, which it's proven it cannot do. And number two, it will also create employment, which it cannot do.
The Federal Reserve has the power to issue and create currency.
But this gives it an inside track to give money at very low, if any, interest rates to its member banks, to the members of the oligarchy who control that bank. Meanwhile, it loans money to the country at interest, making incredible profits and making certain that the United States can never be sovereign again so long as the Federal Reserve exists.
Thomas Jefferson, in a letter to one of his friends after he was out of office, he said, whenever public servants are paid by something other than what the people produce, the roles of master and servant are reversed.
With the central bank, everything becomes consolidated in the hands of the few. Goes back to, again, four simple words: too big to fail. Central banks, look what they've done. They're robbing the people right in front of everybody's eyes as we speak.
The Fed was established when Congress passed the Federal Reserve Act in 1913. The original legislation was introduced by Senator Nelson Aldrich, a frontman for the banking community. Few Americans today recognize his name. Nonetheless, many have heard of Nelson Rockefeller, who was Gerald Ford's vice president and long New York's governor, one of America's richest men. His full name? Nelson Aldrich Rockefeller, named for his grandfather, Nelson Aldrich. Aldrich's daughter married John D. Rockefeller Jr., and his son Winthrop became chairman of the Rockefeller's Chase National Bank. When Nelson Aldrich spoke on Capitol Hill, insiders knew he acted for the Rockefellers and their allies. The legislation Aldrich introduced, which became the Federal Reserve's basis, was crafted by several of America's richest bankers. At a secret 9-day meeting in 1910 on Jekyll Island off the Georgia coast. At that time, Jekyll Island was an exclusive retreat for the wealthy elite. In attendance were agents from the world's three greatest banking houses, those of John D. Rockefeller, J.P. Morgan, and the Rothschilds. Acting for the Rockefellers were Senator Aldrich and Frank Vanderlip. Representing the Morgan interests were Benjamin Strong, head of J.P. Morgan's Bankers Trust Company, Henry Davison, senior partner in J.P. Morgan & Company, and Charles Norton, head of Morgan's First National Bank of New York. The most important figure who ran the meeting was the Rothschilds' agent, Paul Warburg. Paul Warburg belonged to a German banking family associated with the Rothschilds, the world's most powerful banking dynasty, who had grown rich by establishing central banks that loan money to European countries. Its patriarch, Amschel Mayer Rothschild, said, "Permit me to issue and control the money of a nation, and I care not who makes its laws." In 1901, Warburg immigrated to America intending to establish a similar central bank in the United States. He became a partner in Kuhn Loeb & Company, the Rothschilds' banking satellite in New York City.
Who controls the Federal Reserve is pretty secretive, but for the most part, we understand who controls it, and we know many of the families specifically involved. And it's what's known as the Eastern Establishment, many of the banking houses that have come to dominate the 20th century, and of course, the robber barons who became monopolists of the major industries of the U.S.
The Rothschilds had long been allied with America's two foremost banking families, the Rockefellers and Morgans, providing the seed money for John D. Rockefeller's Standard Oil Company and helping bail out J.P. Morgan when his firm was financially distressed. The axis of Warburg, Rothschild, Morgan and Rockefeller and their Wall Street confederates became known as the Money Trust. President Wilson named Paul Warburg vice chairman of the Federal Reserve Board. Benjamin Strong was appointed to run the New York Fed, the system's nucleus. The men who had secretly planned the bank now controlled it. At the time, Congress and the public had no inkling of the Jekyll Island meeting. Paul Warburg's annual salary at Kuhn Loeb had been $500,000, equal to well over $10 million in today's dollars. He relinquished that for a Federal Reserve position that paid $12,000. Warburg knew it would be far more profitable to control America's interest rates and make the stock market rise or fall at will. Congressman Charles Lindbergh Sr., father of the famous aviator, helped lead the fight against the Federal Reserve Act. In 1913, he declared on the floor of the House,
"This act establishes the most gigantic trust on earth. When the president signs this act, The invisible government by the money power proven to exist by the money trust investigation will be legalized. The money power overawes the legislative and executive forces of the nation. I have seen these forces exerted during the different stages of this bill. From now on, depressions will be scientifically created. The new law will create inflation whenever the trust wants inflation. If the trust can get a period of inflation, they figure they can unload stocks on the people at high prices during the excitement and then bring on a panic and buy them back at low prices. The people may not know it immediately, but the day of reckoning is only a few years removed.
The day of reckoning, Lindbergh predicted, came with Black Thursday and the Great Crash of 1929. The crash wiped out millions of small investors, but not the money trust. Warburg, Rockefeller, Morgan, Bernard Baruch, and other top insiders had already exited the market. Although friendly biographers attribute their perfectly timed departure to their fiscal wisdom, fiscal foreknowledge of the Federal Reserve policy they controlled rigged the game in their favor. The Federal Reserve nearly doubled the discount rate between January and August of 1929. The bankers also pressured stocks down by heavily selling the market short and massively calling loans on investors who had borrowed to invest in stocks, forcing the borrowers to sell stock to repay the loans. These tactics converged, generating a snowballing panic that would bring the entire country into the greatest financial depression since the Civil War. Congressman Lewis McFadden, chairman of the House Committee on Banking and Currency from 1920 to 1931, had this to say.
It was not accidental. It was a carefully contrived occurrence. The international bankers sought to bring about a condition of despair here so that they might emerge as rulers of us all.
Afterwards, the money trust returned to the market, exactly as Congressman Lindbergh predicted. They bought up stocks that once sold for $10 per share at $1 per share, widening their ownership of corporate America.
Well, the Fed affects prices by devaluing the dollar. So every time you devalue the dollar by a little bit more, it costs that much more to purchase a good. When I talk to people who are struggling with the value of their money, and they talk about the need for a minimum wage to be higher, for instance, because they say, well, we've got to make more, we're not making a living wage. What they never seem to connect is the fact that part of the reason they don't make a living wage is because the value of what they're being paid continues to drop.
It's not what the young people are doing wrong, it's what's been done to them. When great-grandpa came here in 1900, there was no income tax back then. People today are spending about half their income on taxation. It's true when you take your federal income tax, state income tax, real estate tax, Social Security tax, sales tax, excise tax, utility tax. You are paying about half your income in taxation. Now, doesn't it make sense? If you pay half your income to taxes, you'll need two jobs to maintain the same standard of living that one job used to pay for.
So if you understand who these people are, and you understand what their mission is and how they think and what their ideology is, then most of the mysteries of the modern world, of how come we're getting into this mess, or why are we doing this, and so forth, they become easy to answer. If you don't understand that little twist of that word, really, runs America, it's not the voters, then all of these things remain a mystery.
Who's the guy that deregulated the Glass-Steagall Act and the banking acts that were put together in 1933 following the crash of 29 because of what Wall Street and the banks did? Robert Rubin under Clinton. Where was he from? Goldman Sachs. Who's the head of the European Central Bank? Mario Draghi. Where's he from? European director of Goldman Sachs. Who's the fellow that's running the Bank of England? Mark Carney? Oh yeah, him. Where's he from? Goldman Sachs.
And it's the bankers, it's the heads of international corporations, it's the existing power structure. And people say, well, if we don't have government, we won't be protected from the evils of rich people. And it's like, no, I'm sorry, when you have a government, what you have done is put an army of enforcers at their disposal.
The United States is run like a major corporation.
The 20th century in the United States has been one of centralization, as it has been around the world. It's partly due to the rise of technology, and it's partly due to the consolidation of these banking powers.
So who really runs America? The global money paradigm really runs America, but the people, if they have consensus, and I think we can give several examples, the global food revolution is certainly one example where you see people from Occupy Wall Street and people from the Tea Party, people from all different segments of society coming together to say, we want clean food. And you notice that this is maybe one of our most successful endeavors. So I like to think the truth is that the people and consensus run America, but if we don't do it and we don't spend time doing that, then the global money paradigm runs America like they run everywhere else.
So it's killing everybody. It's costing everybody to live more and everyone's earning less. The numbers don't lie. The numbers are there for everybody to look at. Median household income is below 1999 levels. Kids with college degrees, half of them have jobs that only require a high school education. They're robbing us right in front of our eyes. And you have slime ball politicians and prostitutes on these business shows that keep the lie going. Too big to fail.
What's going to kill the dollar is when people realize that it's a system of exploitation that funds oppression, that funds wars, that funds the police state, that funds all of the regulations that are keeping you from being able to conduct your business the way that's going to make you happy, and they abandon it. That's what's going to kill the dollar.
Hey, the power's in our hands. Now that we know what the game is they're loaning our own money at interest and putting us in debt so far that this country will crash. Bad austerity will come to this country. This is right off the IMF's, World Bank's plans to go in and wreck countries. The chickens have come home to roost. But don't call for the end of the Fed unless you have a pretty clear idea, some kind of consensus of what we're going to have in its place.
The Federal Reserve itself does not have absolute autonomy to act as it wants within the global system. It acts according to the international body of the Bank for International Settlements. The Federal Reserve by default inherits some of that secrecy, if you will. And we'll never know what happens, what really goes on inside the Bank for International Settlements, much less the Fed.
What can be done about it? Well, not a whole lot unless Congress gets off their hands and does something about it.
The most significant mechanism for forcing the U.S. dollar on the American people and on the world as the world reserve currency is through requiring it for payments of taxation. And you can't pay your taxes even if you're engaging in barter. You're supposed to be reporting all of that. You're supposed to be paying your taxes in U.S. dollars. So there's an inherent demand for that. There are certain things you can only use dollars for, and therefore it becomes the dominant currency. And there are some things that you really can't avoid it for. You know, if you want to park on the street here, you know, you got to put coins in the meter. If you, are doing something in your life that exposes you to a tax liability, that means you've given the government an excuse to steal from you that is generally accepted by their enforcers. Yes, I understand there's no way around it, but there's a very simple way that you can opt out of the system by doing as much as your, you know, economic transactions as possible in non-dollar denominated currencies, either gold, silver, or what's really exciting now that's opening things up is cryptocurrency, Bitcoin being just the first of many.
In January 1919, 2 months after the armistice, the delegates of the victorious powers arrived in Paris for the peace conference to draw up the terms to be offered to the defeated countries. In all, the representatives of 27 nations attended that conference.
Who did Wilson appoint to head the American delegation to the peace conference? Paul Warburg, who he'd also named vice chairman of the Federal Reserve. How could Warburg, a recent immigrant, be the only person qualified for this critical position? Who did Wilson bring to Paris as chief economic advisor? Bernard Baruch, to whom he made all those campaign pledges. As always, the president was under the watchful eye of Edward Mandel House, the banker's frontman. Wilson did not invite any leading Democratic Party members to Paris. Not one senator or congressman accompanied him. Only the bankers and their entourage. At this conference, Wilson presented his famous 14 points. The most important of them called for establishing the League of Nations. Many people think he invented the League, but it originated with House and the bankers. Ray Stannard Baker, Wilson's official biographer, said,
"Practically nothing, not a single idea in the covenant of the League was original with the president."
Charles Seymour, House's official biographer, said, "Wilson approved the House draft almost in its entirety, and his own rewriting of it was practically confined to phraseology." What were the bankers seeking in the League? World government. The Paris Conference produced the Versailles Treaty, which officially established the League of Nations. Ironically, though Wilson had proposed the League, the United States did not join. The U.S. Constitution stipulated no president could single-handedly make a treaty. The Senate had to ratify it. The Senate rejected the Versailles Treaty. Americans had helped win the war, but saw no reason to join an organization that might infringe on their sovereignty. When news of the Senate vote reached Paris, the bankers reacted swiftly. They held a series of meetings and resolved to form a new organization in the United States. Its purpose would be to change the American opinion so the nation would accept world government. In 1921, that organization was incorporated in New York City as the Council on Foreign Relations. The Council's original roster reveals that most members were bankers or lawyers affiliated with J.P. Morgan and Company. For example, Morgan's personal attorney, John W. Davis, was the CFR's founding president. Morgan's attorney, Paul Cravath, was founding vice president. Morgan's partner, Russell Leffingwell, was first chairman. Since this looked unsuitable for a foreign affairs association, the council diversified its roster by adding professors. However, these came from universities receiving large grants from the Morgan interests. The professors, carefully screened, could be relied on to attend council meetings, then return to the universities and preach the glories of global government. By the late 1920s, the Rockefellers had brought their people into the council. David Rockefeller was the CFR's chairman for many years and is still honorary chairman in 2014. One way the council influences government policy is through publications, including many books and especially its periodical Foreign Affairs, a virtual instruction manual for U.S. foreign policymakers. Time magazine has called it the most influential journal in print.
They do have a publication which my husband subscribes to. We've been reading it for a number of years because of the jaw-dropping insight that it provides into what they're thinking. And they don't mince words in there. They will come right out and say that we need to have this form of control, we need to do this form of manipulation, we need to convince people of these certain sets of beliefs. And you read this, and it's written in a very highfalutin, erudite, academic kind of a style, so you have to get past that to really get to the gist and the meat of what's being said.
The CFR's most important means of controlling policy is supplying cabinet-level and sub-cabinet-level personnel to the government. What policies have the Council created? Let's take examples from after World War II. The League of Nations had effectively collapsed with the war's onset. Its successor was the United Nations, a bolder step toward world government. The UN began with a group of CFR members in the State Department. Working under Secretary of State Cordell Hull, they called themselves the Informal Agenda Group. The group drew up the original plan for the UN, then consulted three attorneys, all CFR members, who declared the scheme constitutional. Subsequently, they met with President Roosevelt, who approved the plan and publicly announced it the same day. After that, FDR made establishing the UN his top priority for post-war planning, just as the League of Nations had been to Wilson. At the UN's founding conference in San Francisco in 1945, most of the American delegates, 47, were CFR members.
The Korean War was designed to empower the UN. It had been the objection of some people that the UN could never actually enforce peace. And so, since the very first plank of the UN Charter says it's there to secure peace, this war was designed to validate the UN as peacekeeper. Even though 90% of the troops were American, it was said to be a UN action. And it was also a way of bypassing the Congress, We have never had a declaration of war since World War II. Once we got into the UN, that was it. Harry Truman sent troops to Korea without so much as consulting the Congress.
By instituting policies through, for example, the United Nations, they're able to say, here's something we want to happen to every single person on planet Earth. And I'll give an example. A couple of years ago, Desmond Tutu, Bishop Desmond Tutu, came out in support of a United Nations plan to number all the children. Their concern was that not all of the kids being born on planet Earth were making their way into a government database where they were being numbered and tracked. And so they came out with a program called PLAN that the phrase for this was, or their buzzword was, write me down, make me real.
America's post-war program of aid to Europe, the Marshall Plan, was allegedly the brainchild of General George Marshall, who proposed it in a Harvard commencement speech. In reality, it was not conceived by Marshall, but by a CFR study group with David Rockefeller as secretary. They originally intended President Truman to announce the proposal and call it the Truman Plan. However, after deliberating, they decided that Truman, a Democrat, might not win the support from congressional Republicans. Marshall, a CFR cohort, was chosen to reveal the plan because, as a military figure, he would be misperceived as politically neutral and win bipartisan support. The strategy worked.
The Marshall event is one of those things that people recognize from the history books, but you read a basic summary and you gloss over it. But it has huge importance for the building of the global system that happened in the wake of World War II, when essentially power was up for grabs and in fact had been negotiated ahead of time.
The Marshall Plan was just another giant welfare plan. It weakened America financially, certainly designed more for control of these little nations that they were rebuilding a lot more than it was to help them.
Americans were told the funds were for Europe's needy. They were not told, however, that the goods their tax dollars purchased came mostly from multinational corporations linked to the CFR. The Marshall Plan was even more sinister. Unknown to most Americans, Europeans paid for Marshall Plan goods with printing press money called counterpart funds. CFR member John J. McCloy, appointed High Commissioner to Germany, was in charge of this cash. He was approached by Jean Monnet, renowned as founder of the Common Market, predecessor of today's European Union. Time called him the father of Europe. In 1947, Monnet sent agents to McCloy, who put millions of dollars in counterpart funds at their disposal. This money jump-started the movement for European unity. It financed common market propaganda and a European Union youth movement, as well as schools that would promote European consolidation. The Council of Europe's first meeting in 1949 and election campaigns of favored candidates. Journalist Richard Rovere called McCloy chairman of the establishment, an insider's insider. When he returned to the U.S., he became chairman of both the Council on Foreign Relations and the Rockefeller's Chase Manhattan Bank. McCloy was also second president of the World Bank, which, like its sister, the International Monetary Fund, or IMF, was started at the Bretton Woods Conference.
The Bretton Woods Agreement, where the IMF and World Bank were created, also created a reconstruction vehicle for Europe, which allowed the financial investments to flow through the central banks of choice and flow outward to what became American firms who got most of the business to rebuild Europe. It came with strings attached, and most of the European countries were under the yoke of U.S. command during the reconstruction phase of what was known publicly as the Marshall Plan, but privately was concocted by the Wise Men, a group of very influential foreign policy people who are all members of the Council on Foreign Relations, and many of them also members of Skull and Bones. World War II was really about reshaping the world, giving birth to one version of the New World Order, which would be remade over and over again.
As with the Marshall Plan, the motive was never charity. After World War II, the New York banks wanted to continue loaning money to governments. However, what if war-torn nations had difficulty repaying? A fall guy was needed to guarantee the loans. Taxpayers. The World Bank and IMF gave carte blanche to the private banks, who could now make virtually any loan, however foolish, to foreign governments. If the government could not make an interest payment, the IMF or World Bank would bail them out with taxpayer money.
billions of 1944, 45, 47 taxpayer dollars were poured into the construction of Europe. Untold sums of money that flowed through the central banks and out to the fascist partners of choice who would get the bids and the contracts to rebuild Europe, while the Council on Foreign Relations policy people helped to rebuild Europe along the lines that they wanted to see. Economic controls, wage controls, industrial agreements, and what became the footprints and baby steps and building blocks of the European Union that we see today.
Jesse Helms, former chairman of the Senate's Foreign Relations Committee, said,
"The New York banks have found important profit centers in lending to countries plunged into debt. This has been an essentially riskless game for the banks because the IMF and the World Bank have stood ready to bail the banks out with our taxpayers' money."
Furthermore, the World Bank and IMF often attach conditions to these loans. They may demand a voice in government policy. For example, they might dictate that a country privatize industries to multinational corporations before money comes through. The World Bank and IMF are instruments of profit and control.
And the U.S. foreign policy based in Washington enabled it all the way and put the key people in position to outright rule Europe until it was rebuilt along the designs of not God, not man, not national governments, but the emerging world government based in the Council on Foreign Relations and their money powers.
I look at the World Bank and the IMF more or less as the next stage of the evolution of international banking.
The Bank for International Settlements, along with the World Bank and along with the IMF, have long been viewed as the engine of globalization. These have been the troika, if you will, that have impressed policies on countries all over the world to toe the globalist line.
We're told that this is necessary in order to regulate trade or in order to pacify nations that would be making war against us. But in fact, what this is about is creating debt.
People talk about the one world government or globalists as if we're just going to create one nation that all has the same name. But I don't think that's even necessary. We have banking systems that control the trade, they control what people do for a living. There are people who are living in African nations right now growing cotton in those nations. And those farmers are required to grow cotton because it's part of the debt payback that goes to these huge globalist banks who have made loans to the country. And they can't compete with other countries around the world. The farmers want to grow something else because their margins are so small, and they're not allowed to simply because of the debt that is owed by their nation.
Nam's a difficult one. Could the war have been won? Well, you probably know some Vietnam veterans, and a lot of them were harmed during the war. There's issues with things like Agent Orange. A lot of them are sour because there's just a lingering confusion about what really happened during that war.
Every war is won by the people who profit from it. It has always been the case because war is a racket, as Major General Smedley Butler said, always has been, always will be. Poor men dying in rich men's wars. The Vietnam War was won by those who made billions from it.
Every war we've had, at least since World War II, there was not a clear objective as to what we were doing as a nation in going there. What was the objective in Vietnam? I'm not sure most people even still know today.
You can't win a war unless you know what winning it means. We tend to think that the purpose of the Vietnam War was to fight the Viet Cong, to fight the communists. It wasn't. If that were the purpose of the war, we could have won it quite easily. But the real purpose of the war was much more complex than that.
Since World War II, it's very clear that every conflict we've been involved in doesn't make sense in terms of a clear objective of how to win, or why we win in the first place, what we're hoping to accomplish, other than if you were to say our goal is empire building. Now, if we had wanted to conquer the Vietnamese and ultimately occupy their nation, at least that's an objective that has a clear end game to it. But we didn't seem to want to do that. So what were we actually doing?
the reasons behind it seem very confusing unless you know about the banker issue, unless you understand how the engine of America has been hijacked by the banking powers and its nebulous, ill-advised policies directed by the Council on Foreign Relations.
Perhaps no 20th century event impacted America more than the Vietnam War. The war, which lasted 14 years and ended in defeat, was called unwinnable by the establishment media, who blamed the U.S. military, claiming they had underestimated the communist forces under Ho Chi Minh.
That war was part of the proxy wars that happened all around the globe in the name of fighting communism. But it was also a means of reconstructing the Asian Pacific sphere of influence to make it safe for globalism. Again, the whole world had to be made over and brought up to standards for globalism. China being such a major power, Japan more or less under the yoke of the post-World War II agreements, and Vietnam down there on the triangle had to be basically reformed. That was the real reasons for the war. What we were told as Americans was not that we were fighting for our freedoms, not that we were stopping an evil that would take over the whole planet, but that we had been attacked on a ship, the Gulf of Tonkin, an incident that we now know clearly in history didn't happen the way we were told at all.
The media's memory was short. After World War II, U.S. foreign policy dictated that France leave Vietnam. The United States initially supported Ho Chi Minh. In 1945, the OSS, forerunner of the CIA, trained Ho's army and provided him with guns and 20,000 cartridges, which he used to fight the French. The U.S. press glorified him. In 1946, Newsweek compared him to George Washington. In 1954, with its troops hemmed in by Ho's forces at the critical Battle of Dien Bien Phu, France begged the United States to intervene. An aircraft carrier strike would have averted disaster, but the U.S. government refused. Following the French pullout and the division of Vietnam into the North and South, U.S. foreign policy's next objective was removing Emperor Bao Dai, the one man capable of uniting the country. Bao Dai exclaimed,
"If your country had given me 1,000 of the sum they spent to depose me, I could have won that war."
Through a rigged plebiscite, No Dinh Diem, the CFR's choice, was installed as South Vietnam's president. The South Vietnamese hated the oppressive Diem, who drove many into the communist arms. In the meantime, CIA Colonel Edward Lansdale, CFR member, oversaw the disarming of three powerful anti-communist groups in Vietnam: the Cao Dai sect, Hoao Hao sect, and Lee Van Bien's private army. Having sponsored Ho Chi Minh and destroying French, imperial, and local opponents at every level, our CFR policymakers now launched the tragic conflict. World War II. The USA fights on two fronts, Europe and the Pacific. The Germans and Japanese were tough and well-equipped, yet we crushed both military empires with our allies' help in just 3.5 years. On the other hand, we spent 14 years fighting little North Vietnam and lost. Something is terribly wrong with this picture. Defense Secretary Robert McNamara forbid the Air Force to strike over 90% of the strategic targets it wanted to hit. As a CFR member, he left the Defense Department to become president of the World Bank. Then there were the rules of engagement, not declassified until 1985, when they consumed 26 pages of the Congressional Record's fine print. According to the rules, American soldiers were not allowed to shoot first, but had to wait until fired upon. If a pilot saw MiG on the ground, he could not attack. He had to wait until it was airborne and showing hostile intent. If a surface-to-air missile launch site was under construction, he couldn't bomb it. He had to wait until it was operational. If we had fought World War II under such restrictions, we would have lost.
To me, at least, it's clear that the purpose of the war was not to defeat communism in Vietnam. because they could have done that quite easily, but as everyone knows by now, they deliberately put handcuffs on our military, made sure you don't go too far into the enemy territory, you don't counterattack, you don't bomb the supply lines, you just powder puff war all the way along. We call it powder puff war because it wasn't aimed at victory, but that's probably not doing it justice because there was so many lives tragically lost. It was a bloody war, really, but it was not fought to win.
In 1968, journalist Lloyd Milan interviewed nearly a dozen retired high-ranking U.S. military officers. Each, queried separately, said the war would be won in weeks or months with the restraints lifted. This would allow the war to be carried out aggressively against the North. The media claimed the war was initiated by right-wing anti-communists or hawks. The first U.S. combat troops went to Vietnam in 1961. President Kennedy authorized sending about 10,000 men on the advice of the State Department's Walt Rostow, who had just returned from a fact-finding mission to Vietnam. Although the press portrayed Rostow as a hawk, his father had been a Marxist revolutionary in Russia. Two of his aunts belonged to the U.S. Communist Party. His brother, Eugene Debs Rostow, was named after Socialist Party leader Eugene Debs, and the Eisenhower State Department rejected Walt for employment three times as a security risk. The Kennedy administration could only get him in by firing Otto Otepka, the State Department's head of security. In a book published the year before his advice to Kennedy, Rostow wrote,
"It is a legitimate American national objective to see removed from all nations, including the United States, the right to use substantial military force to pursue their own interests. Since this right is the root of national sovereignty, it is therefore an American interest to see an end to nationhood, as it has been historically defined."
This statement summarized the outlook of the Council on Foreign Relations, to which Rostow belonged.
Johnson had to give some very awkward and rather embarrassing speeches convincing America why Vietnam, why he was sending their sons, their brothers, their fathers off to war.
As earlier noted, Congress authorized President Johnson to intervene in Vietnam through the Tonkin Gulf Resolution, written before the two alleged attacks on the U.S. Navy in the Tonkin Gulf. Admiral Stockdale testified that the second attack never happened. The premature resolution was written by William P. Bundy, Assistant Secretary of State for Far Eastern Affairs and member of the CFR. Like Rostow, Bundy was portrayed as a hawk. Yet, in the 1950s, Bundy headed the defense fund for Soviet spy Alger Hiss. After Bundy left the State Department, David Rockefeller appointed him editor of Foreign Affairs, Journal of the CFR, and America's leading opponent of national sovereignty. In 1964, President Johnson successfully ran for re-election against Republican Barry Goldwater, whom the press branded a warmonger. After the election, Johnson himself suddenly began escalating the war, committing hundreds of thousands of troops. He made the decision at the urging of a secret clique called the Wise Men, 14 senior advisors, 12 of whom were CFR members.
The Wise Men included a number of important Council on Foreign Relations members, six key members actually, Avril Harriman, Robert Lovett, and John J. McCloy, all three of them Bonesmen, and all three of them very closely tied to the banking powers of New York City and to the Rockefeller family. John J. McCloy's resume reads like a true globalist. He was a Skull and Bones member. He was a member of the Council on Foreign Relations. He was in the staff as an Undersecretary of State during World War II, and he would later go on to head the Rockefeller Foundation. He was the president of the Council on Foreign Relations for a solid decade, and he was head of the World Bank.
The leader of the Wise Men, who led the demand for escalation, Dean Acheson. Even before the United States recognized the USSR in 1933, the murderous dictator, Joseph Stalin, selected young attorney Acheson to represent Soviet interests in America. Truman's Secretary of State, Acheson, surrounded himself with communist and security risks, such as John Stewart Service, John Carter Vincent, and Lachlan Curry. He promoted Service even after the FBI caught him passing government secrets to communist agents. Acheson's law partner was Donald Hiss, brother of Soviet spy Alger Hiss and a member of the Communist Party. In short, the men who maneuvered us into Vietnam were not anti-communist, but soft on communism or even pro-communist. Nor were they flag-waving patriots. They were globalists who opposed nationalism in favor of world government.
Part of it was to train an international military force, to get the world used to thinking of solving conflicts through international groups such as the UN, and to develop those mechanisms.
Nearly all key policy planners during the Vietnam War were CFR members. The same clique that involved us in the war authored the rules of engagement and other restrictions preventing victory. Clearly, Vietnam was not a blunder, but happened as planned.
So Avril Harriman, Robert Lovett, John J. McCloy, and their associates like George Kennan manipulated policy around the Vietnam War and most of the other conflicts that we saw during the middle years after World War II. All of them mired in confusion, lies, manipulated data, cables, communications that were presented in a framed, skewed manner to goad America into the policy decisions being made in New York City, not in Washington, D.C.
One of their goals, successfully implemented, was to provoke an American political slide to the left in a furor of anti-patriotism, epitomized by the burning of American flags on college campuses. Destroying patriotism is prerequisite to absorbing nations into a one-world government.
But we lost the jobs. We lost the wealth. Our middle class now has been decimated in America. It's getting smaller every year. People are getting poorer every year. Our opportunities for success are dimming every year. And we wave to the factories and to the industries that moved overseas and say, gee, that's too bad.
The North American Union is just one proposal that some people see as an opportunity that's going to enhance their use of the racket to rip people off.
You're not going to get a world government overnight. What's going to happen is you will get regional governments, and of course we've seen this with the creation of the EU, and all of the trauma that goes with that, that they've been experiencing over there, of trying to bring together multiple countries under a single currency, under a single economic system. Whenever people start talking about North American Union and linking us up, then I think, well, what's next? Then a South American Union, and then we join with the EU, and then before you know it, you actually have wound up with your global government.
When they consolidate and centralize power and decision-making processes in these regional communities, it's going to be a very much simpler process for them to then consolidate power from those regional areas, because there'll only be a few of them, and then to bring that together will be child's play in comparison to trying to bring together hundreds of countries worldwide.
North American Union is especially dangerous, as are, again, many of these free trade agreements like the TPP. Why? Because they trump our Constitution.
What they have to do is they have to line up the regulations in countries to mesh together, to not fight each other. So you see this going on in Europe, you see this going on in Asia, you see it going on in the current negotiations with the Trans-Pacific Partnership, for instance.
The TPP, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, aims to say that any American law, including any constitutional law, is suspended in place of the TPP. That includes corporations operating in the United States. They would fall under the authority of the TPP before they would fall under the authority of the U.S. Constitution. That's a huge problem. Same thing with the North American Union. Would we then have some agreement that trumps our Constitution?
It's all about regulation. You say, well, why? It's because they want to get them meshed together and lined up together so they can interoperate without national boundaries and national issues, you see.
That the moment when America announced through then President George W. Bush that we were at war with terror, I think it was actually a truthful statement, but it was a terrible moment for the country. But the terror wasn't what they claimed that it was.
$60 billion worth of spying on we the people? It's not about protecting us from Al-Qaeda or Al-Nusra or Al Capone.
The war on terror, in my opinion, has become a war on the Bill of Rights.
The war on terror has impacted the freedom on the people of the United States and the people of the entire world using fear.
So the revolution apologizes for shitting all over your apathy.
What people have to understand how this process works is fear is what always shuts consciousness down.
The war on terror is to keep the people in fear and hysteria because fear stops everything.
And what are you willing to give up in a war with your own fear?
How does the war on terror fit in? The Department of Homeland Security has given the U.S. government unprecedented power to intrude on citizens' private lives. The ostensible purpose? Combat terrorism. We all oppose terrorism, but many wonder how that word might eventually be defined.
The legislation that came out of the war on terror has been disastrous for the American public and for freedom in general, especially that part of it which has completely ruined privacy in America. Another way to look at it is creation of a total surveillance society.
When we lose the fundamental right to privacy, you could make the argument that really we have no freedom at all. Virtually every piece of our electronic correspondence is being recorded and monitored by some branch of the federal government, all in the name of national security.
What the war on terror has done is said, what will you trade in order to not feel afraid anymore? And unfortunately, as a nation, we said everything. We'll trade everything.
They can put you in jail, hold you indefinitely under the Patriot Act. You know, and what is all this? It's all based on the war on terrorism. And where did that get started? With 9/11. And nobody wants to look at 9/11, but if you look at it hard enough, you'll realize that the whole official story is full of holes.
And so what has happened in a very incremental way is turning everyone into a terrorist for whatever reason. We just heard Senator Reid say that the people that went to the Bundy Ranch are terrorists. The military are acting like terrorists. We're acting like terrorists. If you don't agree with your whatever, dog catcher or water meter reader or whatever, you're a terrorist.
So again, we're back to the same thing as with the communists, which is today, a terrorist is just anyone who disagrees with you. And it is polarizing and fragmenting society.
The concept of Homeland Security did not originate after the Twin Towers attack, but with a 1998 proposal by the United States Commission on National Security, which had 12 members, 9 of whom belonged to the CFR. They recommended a National Homeland Security Agency, the very phrase President Bush used 9 days after 9/11. What connects the trade agreements and war on terror? Both are being used to justify North American Union. In 2004, the CFR's Robert Pastor wrote in Foreign Affairs, security fears would serve as a catalyst for deeper integration. The Department of Homeland Security should expand its mission to include continental security, a shift best achieved by incorporating Mexican and Canadian perspectives and personnel into its design and operation. Pastor is thus suggesting that security concerns warrant combining NAFTA's economic partners, America, Canada, and Mexico, into a continent-wide Homeland Security Department. In March 2005, in Waco, Texas, President Bush met with Mexican President Vicente Fox and Canadian Prime Minister Paul Martin to discuss integrating their three countries.
The Bush administration's open borders policy and its decision to ignore the enforcement of this country's immigration laws is part of a broader agenda. President Bush signed a formal agreement that will end the United States as we know it, and he took the step without approval from either the U.S. Congress or the people of the United States.
At the time of the Waco meeting, the CFR produced a document, Building a North American Community, which called for the creation by 2010 of a community to enhance security, prosperity, and opportunity for all North Americans. Regional alliances like the EU and SPP are not the end game, simply stepping stones to a one-world government. Leading establishment figure Zbigniew Brzezinski said in 1995, "We cannot leap into world government in one quick step. The precondition for genuine globalization is progressive regionalization." Soviet dictator Joseph Stalin recognized this principle as integral to communist plans for domination, saying,
"Populations will more readily abandon their national loyalties to a vague regional loyalty than they will for a world authority. Later, the regionals can be brought all the way into a single world dictatorship."
This is what the war on terror is designed specifically to accomplish, to keep people in a state of fear, of always looking around the corner for the boogeyman, always looking around the corner for the monster that's about to gobble us up. When people's mindset is in that state of fear, they're not making accurate decision-making processes. But moreover, what they're psychologically looking for is a protector.
So here's an interesting story. During 2012, all the presidential candidates, all their surrogates were coming to Ohio. And I had the privilege of being able to interview President Obama and also the privilege of interviewing Mitt Romney and Paul Ryan. And it was during the Mitt Romney-Paul Ryan interview, when I went in to interview them, you get 5 minutes with the candidate. You know, you go into the room. It's basically a stream of media coming in and out the whole time. What's fascinating is I went into that interview with Romney and Ryan, and I sat down on a bar stool, and they were both on bar stools in front of me, you know, the backdrop behind them. And what was a little bit different about this is while there were a lot of people in the room, and that always happens, there was one guy in particular on a sofa behind me who was sitting there as I walked in. And so I sat down, we start the interview. Now, what's a little bit different about this is typically when you're interviewing someone, it's a one-on-one interview. In this case, it was two-on-one. And so I would, you know, ask one a question and then to the other one, back and forth. What was really interesting to me was as I was talking with them and interviewing them, I would notice out of my peripheral vision, I'm talking with Congressman Ryan, and I could see Governor Romney looking past me at the guy on the sofa behind him. And then when I would turn to Governor Romney and I would interview him, I could see Congressman Ryan doing this. And if you go back, by the way, and you watch the actual full interview, I would tell people, just go back and watch not the guy I'm talking to, watch the other candidate and how they're looking past me at this guy. And it was almost like they're doing, you know, baseball signals at each other. And so they're, you know, kind of go through this. We do the interview, we're all done. And after I left, I was really interested in who the guy was on the sofa behind me. And so I stopped one of the press people on the way out and I said, "Oh, by the way, who's the guy on the sofa?" And they told me his name, which at the time didn't mean anything. And then they said, "Oh, he's with the Council on Foreign Relations and he's advising the candidates." And when he said it, now that got my attention because they said it as if it was a very positive thing, right? Which is, well, you know, Governor Romney needs more experience on foreign issues and foreign affairs. So it's a good thing. In my opinion, of course, it was, oh, great. So you have someone from this globalist think tank who is basically sitting behind me during an interview and letting them know what they should and should not say. So it was kind of an interesting experience.
The freedom of the press and the freedom of religion were supposed to be two of the greatest vanguards of liberty for the country, according to our First Amendment.
The purpose of the broadcast media, or the controlled, formerly mainstream media, has always been to be a propaganda tool for the government, for the superclass. And you can see how this works in a very simple sense in America with the White House and access to the White House press room. If you don't toe the line, if you're not official corporate media, it doesn't matter how big your audience is, we're going to control the conversation. If you can be an appropriate mouthpiece for government, if you're not going to challenge the paradigm of statism, we will give you access.
Americans today are disenfranchised and disempowered because we don't have enough of the relevant information.
Read the quotes from Katie Couric and saying that they got pressure from the administration.
I can't think of a worse scenario for the future of freedom.
If this documentary is true, why are its claims almost never discussed in mainstream media? After all, the Constitution mandates freedom of the press. How could so many news organizations fail to notice the stories we've discussed?
That's because the information we do get has been filtered and framed in particular ways. It can be easily seen in the mainstream media.
You have a mentality within your newsrooms in which people really do honestly believe if networks don't talk about it, it's not a story. So if Fox isn't saying it, if NBC's not saying it, CNN or ABC, if they're not saying it, it can't be true.
Although America has a free press in principle, this does not guarantee accuracy of the press. To achieve its objectives, the establishment always knew it needed to control the media, the primary molder of public opinion.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to a major circulation American journal?
We do have people who submit pieces to other two American journals.
The national news media is, for all intents and purposes, a totally controlled medium. A free and independent press at the national level just does not exist.
Do you have any people being paid by the CIA who are contributing to the national news services, AP and UPI?
Well, again, I think we're getting into the kind of detail, Mr. Chairman, that I'd prefer to handle in executive session.
You know, people will say, why isn't the media doing their job? I beg to differ. The media is doing exactly what they are designed and paid to do. They are steering public perception in the way that the people at the current positions of power want the public perception to go in.
Not continuing Congresswoman Harmon, let me interrupt you. Congresswoman, let me interrupt you just for a moment. We've got some breaking news out of Miami. Stand by, if you will. Right now in Miami, Justin Bieber.
They are the mind molders. They are the opinion molders of America. And if you ask a guy some of the technical questions like you've asked me in the last few minutes on the street, you'll hear him reciting something that Rush Limbaugh or somebody else said on radio or TV.
In the 19th century, August Belmont was a Rothschild financial agent in the United States. With J.P. Morgan, Belmont helped finance Adolph Ox, who purchased the New York Times, then a tiny newspaper with a circulation of 9,000. International banking behind him, Ox transformed the Times into the world's most powerful newspaper. Ownership passed from Ox to his son-in-law, Arthur Hayes Sulzberger, member of the CFR, then to Orville Dreyfus, CFR, then to Arthur Ox Sulzberger, CFR.
Well, I think there's a couple of things. You ignore the story because, number one, it doesn't fit with their own personal worldview. There are too many people with the same worldview sitting in those positions. I don't blame Brian Williams for not being interested in covering a story that challenges the globalist thinking of the CFR. I really don't, because he's entitled to his own belief system. The problem is when Brian Williams then prevents any stories that challenge his worldview from being a part of that newscast. And when Brian Williams does it, then Diane Sawyer does it, and you know, so does, you know, Scott Pelley, and it goes on and on and on. And then when all the networks say, well, let's ignore those stories, all the local TV stations around the country say, well, they're not covering it, so it must not be a story, because those guys are the most professional, most legitimate media.
The Times' editorial policy has consistently paralleled the establishment's agenda. When members of Congress opposed Paul Warburg's nomination to the Federal Reserve Board, the Times lobbied on his behalf. When communist Fidel Castro was trying to seize Cuba in 1959, a series of articles by New York Times reporter Herbert L. Matthews, CFR, persuaded Americans that Castro was the George Washington of Cuba. By 1962, Castro had Soviet missiles pointed at America. During the Vietnam War, the Times demoralized the public by publishing an alleged exposé of the war's origins, the Pentagon Papers, a leaked Defense Department study. Leslie Gelb, who oversaw the study, went on to be a Times correspondent and editor. So will Gelb do an exposé of the CFR? It's not likely anytime soon. He was the council's president for 10 years and remains president emeritus.
If you're one of those CFR members of the news media, If you're Brian Williams, who's a member of the CFR, if you're Aaron Burnett, who's a member of the CFR, if you're sitting there in your newscast that night and some story comes across about, you know, we should look into the Federal Reserve Bank, you're probably not going to do that. You're going to ignore that. If people are protesting the Federal Reserve Bank, are we going to talk about that? No, we're not going to.
Innumerable Times executives, editors, and reporters have been CFR members. The Times won't expose the CFR because they both belong to the same hierarchy. A similar picture can be sketched of other major news organizations. Media diversity is an illusion.
People get caught up in debating if MSNBC has a better perspective than Fox News or ABC, NBC. These are a very narrow window of information.
Here's your news. Here's the report on what's happening through the Republican lens, through the liberal lens. But they're not getting down to the roots and down to the basics and saying, here's the true fundamental problems in society and here's the true solutions.
There is this illusion in America we have a diverse media because we have so many diverse outlets. And a person might say, well, I know this story is true because I saw it on America Online, and then I turned on my television and CNN said the exact same thing. And then later in the week, I got my Time magazine and it said the exact same thing. Now, you know, when a story has been confirmed by independent news outlets like that, it must be true. Well, here's the problem. Until the recent AOL spinoff, America Online, CNN, and Time magazine were all owned by one corporation, Time Warner.
At the national level, it's a surprising small number of people that control the vast majority of the national news media.
It's no surprise that you're not going to see any of this in the mainstream media, because the mainstream media is owned and controlled by five major corporations.
The New York Times Company owns the Boston Globe. The Washington Post Company owns Newsweek. Disney owns ABC. CBS owns Simon & Schuster. Time Warner owns AOL, CNN, Time, Warner Brothers Studios, HBO, New Line Cinema, Sports Illustrated, People, Fortune, Money, and dozens more. News Corporation owns The Wall Street Journal, Fox Television, London's The Times, Barron's, HarperCollins, Zondervan, Hulu, and The New York Post and scores of other media outlets.
When you have one corporate owner, you're going to get one viewpoint. You don't get a diverse view unless you have diverse ownership.
I got a communication from someone who's in a three-letter network, head of a news department for that three-letter network, and said, my family member is in Iraq now, and I was so disturbed at what you said last night about depleted uranium. I don't want to believe this is true. And I said, it is. I gave the evidence, the information, and he said, yes, I've been up all night studying it. You are right. He said, I wish I could tell the people this. And I said, and why can't you? And he said, it's not part of the political paradigm.
Most of America's major media is owned by around a dozen multinational corporations. These, in turn, have directors that interlock through membership in the CFR. Thus, the establishment can guarantee the public receives a uniform viewpoint.
The mainstream media will not cover many of these issues because of, in part, because of the people who pay to sponsor their television shows. When you have major corporations that are doing pretty disgusting things to the mainstream public, paying to have TV exist, they're not going to want the commentators discussing about the things that they are doing and how they're awful.
You're not going to see the truth in mainstream media. And in fact, you're going to see disinformation agents. You'll see people like me smeared in the media. If it comes out at all, the information that we're talking about, you're going to find that it's marginalized.
Once a year, the world's elite from government, banking, industry, and media hold an international summit called the Bilderberg Conference. The meetings are closed to the public. In 1991, speaking before the Bilderbergers, CFR Chairman David Rockefeller described the media policymaker marriage. We are grateful to the Washington Post, the New York Times, Time Magazine, and other great publications whose directors have attended our meetings and respected their promises of discretion for almost 40 years. It would have been impossible for us to develop our plan for the world if we had been subject to the bright lights of publicity during these years. But the world is now more sophisticated and prepared to march towards a world government which will never again know war, but only peace and prosperity.
But I don't think we're buying into it as much anymore. I think that the advent of new media, I think the internet, social media, the ability for people to talk to each other, communicate, share information like at no other time in human history, really renders a lot of the propaganda that we face unusable.
It's very tempting when you look at the short-term trends in the American government and the application of technology and organizations like the NSA to think that we're heading towards a totalitarian surveillance state. But technology is fundamentally empowering, and with all the technology that's on the horizon right now, we see Google Glass as an exciting innovation, but really just scratching the surface of what's about to happen with computers in our brains, if not just in our contact lenses, or better integrated with our lives in general, and the profusion of cameras in society. These are good things in and of themselves. The question is really, who controls these technologies? And it is scary when government controls these technologies, but I'm very confident that technology also empowers greater awareness and is going to lead people to realize that non-coercive, voluntary, peaceful relationships are superior to violent, coercive ones that are the reasons we have to be afraid, not of the technology itself, but of the application of it. So it's really important to be aware of that distinction when fighting back and making sure that we're not making people afraid of the technology itself, but that they know what is correct to be afraid of, which is the government control and usage of these technologies as mechanisms of greater control. But the technology fundamentally empowers us to better control our world, our environment, to be more empowered human beings as individuals. And that is a great thing to be celebrated, if anything, is going to lead government to be obsolete.
We are the individual people of the United States. We need to exercise our rights. Nobody's going to come in on a white horse and rescue you or save the day. This is your job. This is an informed electorate's job. It's our job to inform our elected officials that we refuse to be a part of this plan.